Today you join me aboard one of PSA or Stellantis's most interesting cars in its lineup, the DS3 Crossback E-Tense, which is the electric version of the DS3 Crossback. DS is PSA's, or rather Stellantis's. I haven't gotten used to the name. Whenever I think of this, I think of PSA, which is Peugeot Citroën, but it now owns Opel, Maserati, Alfa Romeo, Chrysler, Fiat, and a few others. But PSA created the DS sub-brand in 2015, before it even thought about acquiring Fiat Chrysler. If you're familiar with the Citroën, then the DS name will surely ring a bell, because the DS sedan is one of Citroën's most iconic models, if not its most iconic model. Probably the best Citroën ever, and one of the best cars ever, the original DS. So they decided to make DS a sub-brand. And before 2015, when DS became its own sub-brand, it was used on several upscale Citroën models. The Citroën DS3, which was a Mini Cooper rival, the DS4, which was a small coupe-like crossover, whose rear windows didn't open at all. And there was also the DS5, which was like a big suppository-shaped thing, but it was pretty nice to be aboard of. It was super comfortable. And it's a great second-hand buy these days, because they depreciate ferociously, and you can get them really cheap, and you get a lot of car for your money. And even though the original DS3 was a regular hatchback with a normal ride height, it wasn't a crossover, this new DS3 is also designated a crossback, and this in DS lingo means it's a crossover. E-Tense, it is DS's designation for its pure electric models. And this car is related to a whole slew of other vehicles. The Peugeot E2008, the Opel Mokka E, as well as the Corsa E from Opel, and the E208 from Peugeot. This car costs around 40,000 euros, just over 40,000 euros, before any government incentives for electric vehicles. So it's not a cheap car, but it does somewhat justify the price tag. So just like all the other cars that I previously mentioned, the DS3 Crossback E-Tense has a 50 kilowatt hour battery pack, a real world range of around 230-250 kilometers, depending on how you drive it. It has a single front-mounted electric motor made by Continental, which puts out 100 kilowatts, or around 136 horsepower. It sprints to 100 kilometers per hour in under 9 seconds, around 8.7 seconds. Its top speed is 150 kilometers per hour, and it weighs around 1.5 tons. It is the heaviest and most expensive DS3 Crossback that you can buy. It is also the only properly electrified version, let's call it, because the others are just mild hybrids. You have three 1.2 liter gas engines, two of which are turbocharged, and the 1.5 liter diesel, and those are like 200 or 300 kilos lighter than this. When it comes to charging, you can charge the DS3 Crossback E-Tense. Oh my god, that's such a long name. I'm just gonna call it a DS3. And I'm not referring to the older DS3, the hatchback, the mini rival. I'm referring to this car. So this DS3 has a maximum charging capacity of 100 kilowatts, good enough to top up its battery to around 80% in half an hour. If you charge it at its maximum onboard charging capacity, which is 11 kilowatts, you're looking at around 5 hours to completely charge it. And while driving this vehicle, I was thinking what vehicles it tries to rival. And frankly, all I got were cars made by the same group, by Stellantis. But since this vehicle is meant to be a premium vehicle, and DS is a premium brand, I guess you could say it also rivals cars like the Mercedes EQA, like the base EQA, the EQA 250. And then there's also the Lexus UX, the fully electric version of the Lexus UX that I'm so curious to drive, because I've heard great things about it. But from what I understand, it's not available in Romania yet. So it's definitely a niche proposition to a degree, because it's quite a bit more expensive than the non-premium vehicles that it's related to that I mentioned earlier, even though technically it's the same vehicle. So I think that's enough background. I'm going to move to the things that I like about it. And the first thing is definitely the way it looks. It's such a strange looking thing, but in a good way. It draws a lot of looks. People seem to like it. People seem to smile when they see it. It's not a very common car, so it's not a common sight, and it stands out on the road when people see it, definitely. I also think it has a very strong identity. You wouldn't mistake it for anything else. It does not look like anything else. There is nothing derivative about it. The front end is dominated by those weird headlights, the big grille with like a diamond pattern in it, the prominent DS badge, and there's another badge on the edge of the hood, like proper luxury cars have. You know, Mercedes, some Mercedes models have two badges up front, just to drive the point home that that's a Mercedes. And that's kind of what the DS is doing with this car. The front end is really, really bold. It gets full LED headlights and they look really, really cool. From the side, I really like the B pillar. It's very unusual. It ends like halfway up the side windows. It's obviously not a structural part, but it's a very unique design touch, I think. It's very unusual. It looks quite tall from the outside, but when you're sitting inside the car, it feels quite snug, but not tight in a bad way. It still feels roomy, but you sit quite low in it, even though from the exterior it does look a bit tall, but it really isn't. I also like the rear end of the vehicle. I love the slim LED rear lights. I'm not so sure about the fake vents on the side of the rear bumper, but other than that, I think this is a very successful vehicle from a design standpoint. And I think the same can be said of the interior that continues the diamond slash triangle pattern that you see on the exterior. So you can see it on the doors here, on the dash, on the seats, on the... Is this aluminum or plastic? I honestly don't know. It might be aluminum, but it's probably plastic. Anyway, you can see the same diamond slash triangle pattern here in the dashboard, in all the buttons. I think it's pretty good. I like the cohesion. You can also see it around the digital gauge cluster. The infotainment has the same pattern in it, even though it's not the best infotainment, but we'll get to that. It's a very boldly designed thing and it makes you feel special, which I think was the goal here. I also like the steering wheel that isn't especially thick. The rim is not thick. It's very comfortable to hold on to. I don't think thick-rimmed steering wheels are as fitting for luxury cars as they are for sporty cars. And I think DS made the right choice by fitting this car with this steering wheel. I also like the gear selector with the E-Tense logo here. It's pretty nice. And I'm not even bothered by the fact that the window switches are on the center console around the gear selector. Another thing I like about this car is how quiet, refined, and comfortable it is. The suspension is quite fluid, although it does get unsettled by bigger bumps, because the rear suspension is not independent. So the two rear wheels are sadly connected by a big girder. If you hit a pothole with one wheel on the left, let's say, the right wheel also is affected, and this sends like judders through the entire chassis. But it's super comfortable 99% of the time. It's very, very relaxing to drive. And even though it's a 136 horsepower motor, isn't really that powerful on paper. But you don't drive on paper, do you? You drive on the road. And on the road, it is very good. It's enough. It doesn't feel underpowered. And it keeps pulling all the way up to its top speed of 150 kilometers per hour. Soundproofing is also surprisingly good. This is especially important in an electric vehicle that doesn't have an engine to drown out some of the noises the car makes. So you need to be very, very good at soundproofing, or sound insulation rather. I also appreciate the very high comfort levels offered by the seats. They are very good seats. These ones are only part leather with the textile material, some sort of nylon on the center part, and they are actually quite soft and pleasant. I like them a lot. I think you can take this car on a long journey and you won't feel strained. even though you can't really drive it that much more than 200 kilometers, as I previously said. Overall, it's nice. There are many things that I like about it, but there are also plenty of negatives that I discovered over this weekend that I got the chance to drive the car. Firstly, I think that some of the materials aren't as good as they could have been. Like, for instance, this is kind of soft, but it's not the highest quality plastic I've ever seen on a door car. It's nowhere near what Mini puts on top of the doors, for instance. And some of the Peugeot parts sharing also detracts from the premium ambiance. Like, I can recognize these door handles from many other Peugeots, and the stalks for the lights and the wipers, and this one for the cruise control, they are lifted from other Peugeots and Citroëns. I also am not a fan of the infotainment system because it's kind of laggy, the graphics aren't the best, and it just annoys me when I prod the screen and nothing happens. There are many other cars that do a much better job than this, even non-premium cars. This was a bit of a disappointment because it honestly feels even slower than on the Peugeot E208 that I tried, which is basically the same system but with a different skin. And while these diamond-shaped shortcuts here for the climate control, heated seats, and the rest of the controls on the center console, they look good, they are all touch-sensitive, and they sometimes work and sometimes they do not. This is a bit of a bummer because they do look good. I also don't understand why on some electric Peugeots you have to keep the starter button pressed to start and turn off the vehicle. Like, I'm sure it's some kind of safety feature, but I don't think other manufacturers do it this way. And it's kind of annoying. I don't really like it. And in an age when manufacturers are beginning to offer augmented reality head-up displays that can span the entire width of the windscreen so you can have things displayed and overlaid over what you're seeing, just like in sci-fi movies from not that long ago, that technology is possible today. And here comes DS with this cheap looking plastic thing that rises out of the dashboard. It's a super old system and it's not the best. It doesn't really look that good. And it's actually kind of annoying. It's in your field of view, but it's not completely transparent. You see its edges, and while it's certainly good to have a head-up display in the car so you don't have to look down, if I really measure the distance where the speed is displayed on the digital driver's display and where it is displayed on the head-up display, I think it's like maybe 10 centimeters. So I would avoid the head-up display. I also would have liked the armrests to be a bit softer, because this one, if you put your elbow on it, you immediately sink past the soft part and you reach the hard part underneath. The same goes for the doors. And you don't have to be a premium manufacturer to get this right, because Mazda, for instance, has amazing squishy armrests that are a true delight to rest your elbow on. And for a 40,000+ euro electric vehicle, the fact that it doesn't have electric seats is a bit mean, I think. Although, frankly, I drove the 60,000+ euro Mercedes EQA and that didn't have them either. And neither vehicle is particularly good from a financial standpoint. They are vehicles you buy because you like the look of them and you want to be seen in them. You don't buy them because they are class-leading. Space for passengers in the rear is not great at all. You don't get an armrest, the windows only roll down about halfway, and it's not the nicest place to sit. And that weird C-pillar that extends only halfway up the door, it continues with some actual metal on the door, which from the outside, again, looks nice, but from the inside, it just makes the windows smaller. So I understand why DS did it. But honestly, I think the car would have been better without this style for style's sake solution. Space in the trunk is also not massive. It's around 300 liters. It's decent, but it could be bigger. And there's kind of a load lip that you have to lift stuff over. Oh, and for the rear passengers, there are also no USBs for them to charge their devices on. With all of this being said, I genuinely have enjoyed my time with the DS3 Crossback E-Tense. I've been curious for over a year about what it's like, and it has not disappointed me. I wasn't expecting it to be perfect, and it is not. It is a bit too expensive for what it offers, I think. And you should just buy, like, if you want an electric crossover that has the same underpinnings, just buy the E2008. But as a style statement, I think it's brilliant. It's nice to be seen in this vehicle. It's a really, really cool thing to behold. And people seem to love it. Everyone I gave a ride to in this vehicle really, really loved it. And they felt special in it. They liked the leather, they liked the style of the thing, and they were generally very impressed. So it's a good vehicle, it's not the best, but if you like the look of it, you won't really be making that many compromises when it comes to practicality and usability. That pretty much sums things up. I hope you enjoyed the video. Thank you for watching until the end. Subscribe if you have not done so. And until the next video, take care.